After conducting a fair amount of research on the topic, I have come to the conclusion that the Taiwanese military is going to be woefully outmatched in any military confrontation with the People's Liberation Army. In this video, it is time to put an end to any delusions of military grandeur around Taiwan. I want to impress upon everybody just how badly the Taiwanese military would be outmatched in a shooting war with the Chinese mainland. In my previous video, which I am going to link below, I have talked about why the United States military would be outmatched should it try to intervene on Taiwan's behalf. That is why I do not believe that the United States military is going to try to intervene to prevent mainland China from reclaiming Taiwan. I do not think that Japan or South Korea or Australia would come to Taiwan's defense because they would likewise be defeated. The Japanese Prime Minister actually said recently that Japan would not come to Taiwan's defense. Donald Trump once famously said that he would not come to Taiwan's defense exactly for these reasons. That the United States would be militarily defeated in such a confrontation is not just my opinion either. This is the conclusion of several very detailed war games conducted by the United States Air Force in 2018 and in 2019 and in 2020, in three separate scenarios, two of which revolved around Taiwan, one of which revolved around a shooting war with China in the South China Sea. In all three war games, the conclusion was that mainland China is able to defeat the United States Navy and the United States Air Force in any confrontation that happens within about 1,000 to 1,500 kilometers of its coasts. Given all of this, I am going to assume a few things. The first thing I am going to assume in an operation to retake Taiwan, I am going to assume that both sides, that is, the Taiwanese military and the People's Liberation Army, are going to be at very high morale. This is not something that will actually happen in a real attempt to retake the island. It is not going to happen for a few reasons. First of all, is because human psychology. When someone sees that they are severely outmatched militarily, they are not going to be as willing to fight, especially if we are talking about conscripts, which much of the Taiwanese military is run by conscripts. Taiwan has been moving away from conscription, but it still has a four-month mandatory military service, and I do not believe that in practice they would be able to draft many reservists. Also because there is a very sizable minority in Taiwan which is pro-CCP, an even larger minority that is pro-reunification, I do not think that they will be willing to take up arms against their Chinese compatriots from the mainland. You have to remember that Taiwan does not view itself as a separate country from mainland China. It simply views itself as the legitimate government of all of China, whereas the People's Republic of China does the same. Both simply consider the other one to be occupied territory. Therefore, both sides consider the people from the other side to be their compatriots. So that is the first thing that I'm going to assume. The second thing that I am going to assume is that a very sizable portion of the PLA, something like 70-80%, is going to be have to either kept in reserve or be have to ready to redeploy to confront a potential American intervention force. While I do not think that America is going to intervene in such a conflict, such a possibility cannot be denied, and I do think that in a real operation, the PLA as a whole would be kept on high alert to counter a potential American intervention force. With all of this in mind, almost everyone agrees that the opening phase of an attempt to retake Taiwan is going to be fought in the air, and that the opening part of this phase of the conflict is going to start with a massive, massive rocket bombardment of all types of military targets, mostly stationary military targets, on Taiwan. I talked a little bit about the PLA Rocket Force in my previous video. That is a branch of the PLA which is dedicated to standoff weaponry, mostly ballistic missiles, but they also operate some cruise missiles. The PLA probably has more standoff weapons than any other military on the planet, more than the United States military, more than the Russian military, both of which also have tons and tons of standoff weapons. But what I would really like to impress upon everybody is the sheer scale of this firepower. We talked about there being thousands and thousands of ballistic missiles in the first part of this video. There are also air-launched missiles, standoff weapons that would be launched from aircraft, glider bombs from hundreds of kilometers. However, there is also artillery. A commonly overlooked fact is that Taiwan is within artillery range of mainland China. This is the PCL-191. It is China's longest range artillery. It can carry a variety of rockets, including those with over 300 kilometers of range. The PCL-191 has enough range to hit all of Taiwan, and it's not even classified as a ballistic missile. The trucks that you can see here can also be equipped to carry two ballistic missiles each. They can carry two ballistic missiles or eight long-range rockets. The difference between a rocket and a ballistic missile is that ballistic missiles are larger, they usually have a little bit more range, they have bigger payloads, they have more advanced guidance systems. However, these rockets are still very accurate. They are estimated to have a CEP of 30 meters. That means they will likely hit their target within 30 meters. They carry a very large warhead, a 150 kilogram or so high explosive warhead. And this is artillery. Rockets are much cheaper. They can be produced and deployed in far, far greater numbers than ballistic missiles. If all of Taiwan, all of Taiwan's military infrastructure is within artillery range of mainland China, then these batteries are enough to wipe out virtually every single military target on Taiwan, every object of any military importance. So we are talking stationary targets like large radars, bunkers, airfields, hangars, military ports. All of these are going to be completely destroyed in the opening minutes of an operation to retake Taiwan. The Taiwanese military is going to be paralyzed at this point. A counter argument that is often made to all of this is that Taiwan has its own standoff weapons. It has its own ballistic missiles. It has its own cruise missiles with which it can likewise destroy targets on the Chinese mainland. That is only somewhat true. Taiwan has a very, very small arsenal by comparison. First of all, a lot of Taiwan's standoff weapons do not have the range to hit the Chinese mainland. For example, this ballistic missile, the Tianqi 3, has a range of only 120 kilometers. That is not enough to cross the Taiwan Strait. Some cruise missiles, such as the Yongfeng, do have the range to hit deep within the Chinese mainland, at least in theory. It is not actually known if this missile is even in service. It was supposed to enter service in 2014, but it is not confirmed as of yet if it is in service 7 years later. I think that it is in service. It is certainly reasonable to assume that it's in service. However, there are several other issues. First of all, Taiwan is a very small island by comparison geographically. All of the military targets on Taiwan are going to be located on this small island. By comparison, China is a huge country. It has more infrastructure and a larger land area than all of Europe. Whereas mainland China is going to be easily able to destroy all critical targets on Taiwan, Taiwan is not going to be able to inflict anything resembling a noteworthy amount of damage to any infrastructure, any military targets in general, in mainland China. The other problem mainland China has much better anti-ballistic missile capabilities and anti-cruise missile capabilities than Taiwan. Mainland China has been setting up anti-missile batteries near Taiwan for many decades now. They know that Taiwan does have some standoff capability, and they have protected themselves from this capability. First of all, we need to talk a little bit about how missile interception works in general, especially when you are intercepting ballistic missiles. It is easiest to shoot down a ballistic missile when that missile is in its boost phase. So the boost phase is when it is just taking off. It is hardest to shoot down that missile in its terminal phase when it is about to hit its target. Because of geography, China can launch its missiles deep within its mainland, and these missiles would not be intercepted by anything because they are simply too far away from any interceptors until they are in their terminal phase. Mainland China, on the other hand, can easily intercept any missiles that Taiwan has while those missiles are still in their boost phase, because not only is Taiwan within arm's reach of mainland China, essentially, but the PLA also has a huge navy. It has lots of capable air defense destroyers and frigates. It can easily position all of its destroyers around Taiwan, around all of the islands that belong to Taiwan, where these missiles might be located. They would be prepared to intercept either cruise missiles or ballistic missiles. The third problem is that a PLA attack would be targeting these standoff weapons that Taiwan has. They would be the very first target. Mainland China knows that Taiwan does have some capability to attack the Chinese mainland using these standoff weapons, and that this is probably the best shot that they have at inflicting some sort of damage. And mainland China is going to try to prevent that. It is going to try to destroy all of these missiles in their bunkers before they can even be used. The amount of damage that a Taiwanese rocket attack can inflict upon the Chinese mainland is thousands and thousands of times less than the damage that a rocket attack by the PLA on Taiwan is going to inflict. After this rocket attack, I think that the entire Taiwanese Air Force is going to be either destroyed in their hangars or that they are simply not going to have the infrastructure to take off. Taiwan has a few highways that they can use to allow their fighter jets to take off, but there are many issues with this. The first issue is that modern aircraft in general require very long runways. An F-16 fighter jet or an F-5 require almost a full kilometer of roadway to take off. Those roads are also going to be targeted, especially if the PLA sees any aircraft taking off from them. Even if we assume that Taiwan can use these highways to allow their aircraft to take off, there is much more to a military airbase than just a takeoff and landing strip. You also have to store the fuel for all of these aircraft somewhere. You also have to store all of the munitions somewhere. All of this is going to be virtually impossible once a PLA rocket attack destroys all military airbases. The same applies to the Navy, by the way. The Navy is going to be destroyed from the air by PLA aircraft and also by submarines. Taiwan does not have many anti-submarine warfare capabilities. It barely has any submarines of its own. So the Navy is going to be completely destroyed. The Air Force, I think, is also going to be destroyed very, very quickly, certainly within the opening hours of the conflict. But even if we assume that somehow a small portion of the Taiwanese Air Force is able to survive this initial bombardment and able to survive successive bombardments, we would have to talk about just how much these aircraft can do against the People's Liberation Army Air Force. This is a picture of the J-20. It is mainland China's most advanced air fighter. Pay attention to the massive nose section. The nose part of the fuselage is so big because it houses a massive radar. It houses a phased array radar, which is not only built with some of the best technology on the planet. Mainland China has amazing radars, has been making amazing radars in the last few years. It also has stealth capabilities. Radars like the one mounted on this aircraft can detect fighter jet-sized targets from many hundreds of kilometers. We're talking four, maybe even more than 400 kilometers away. That is actually fairly close to the radar horizon at a medium or even a high altitude. Taiwanese aircraft, by comparison, are extremely outdated. Taiwan's best aircraft is the upgraded version of the F-16 that they brought from the United States. The F-16 is a fourth generation aircraft. It is a full generation behind in electronics, even in engines, but especially in air-to-air missiles compared to the J-20. I really want to emphasize this point about missiles because most of an aircraft's capability does not come from the actual aircraft itself, but rather from the missiles that it carries. Mainland China has some of the most advanced air-to-air missiles on the planet. The PL-15 has a range that is 1.5 times more than any American air-to-air missile. And there is also the PL-21, which is a little bit too long to be carried by the J-20, at least internally. It can carry them externally, most likely. The PL-21 would mostly be used by fourth-gen aircraft. The PL-21 has more than double the range of the longest-range American air-to-air missile. Taiwan does not even have anything close to the best American air-to-air missiles. They are still using the AIM-120C7, which they brought from the United States. The AIM-120C7 is far behind the AIM-120D, which the United States is currently using. It is more like the missile that they are slowly starting to phase out. The PLA can expect AWACS support. Taiwan does have a few AWACS, but I'm almost certain that all of them would be destroyed, especially since there aren't many of them to begin with. Also, the PLA has much better trained fighter jet pilots. It is very important to have experienced pilots flying all of these aircraft. The PLA Air Force has elite pilots, and you would expect to see nothing but the best of the elite flying something like the J-20. These elite pilots, they have thousands of flight hours. The Taiwanese Air Force, by comparison, does not have many elite pilots. Going by historical precedent, every time within the last 3 or 4 years that there was a large-scale Taiwanese military exercise, it always ended with at least one fatal crash by some aircraft or one accident in general that led to some fatalities. All of this is indicative to problems in the Taiwanese Air Force in terms of flight experience and also in terms of maintenance. Taiwan has lots of maintenance issues, even with much simpler technology than fighter jets. You also have to consider that while we are talking about modernized F-16s, Taiwan only has a couple dozen of them. It has a little bit more than 100 F-16s in total, not all of which are even modernized. However, more than half of the Taiwanese Air Force still uses third-generation aircraft like the F-5, the Mirage 2000, as well as a domestic knockoff of the F-5. It is nothing like the advanced third-generation jets that the PLA uses. The PLA is actively phasing out old aircraft like the MiG-21 or J-7, as it is called in the PLA. These aircraft are mainly used either for ground attack or they are used as trainers. However, more than half of the Taiwanese Air Force still uses these very, very old fighter jets, which, frankly speaking, are no good in any engagement. You also have to keep in mind that Taiwan is actually within range of mainland China's air defenses. China has the S-400. The S-400 has a missile range of 400 kilometers. The middle point of Taiwan is only about 200 kilometers from the Chinese mainland. Mainland China also has tons of their own domestic anti-air batteries. They're mounted both on destroyers, frigates, as well as on the ground, which also have very, very long ranges. And this is where a lot of people make the assertion that Taiwan can still hold its own in the air, even when it doesn't have any aircraft, because Taiwan has its own ground-based air defenses. It is very important to understand that if you have ground-based air defenses and nothing else, and you're fighting a military force like the PLA, the PLA has the best tactical aviation of any country but the United States, and it's catching up even to that. When you are coming up against that kind of air force, your ground-based air defenses have to be extremely good. You have to have not just good technology, but an extremely advanced air defense doctrine in order to prevent all of your equipment from simply being destroyed in a few DAD missions or destruction of enemy air defense missions. In order to explain what kind of measures are needed in order to prevent such an air force from simply destroying all of the vulnerable radars that any long-range air defense system has to rely upon, I want to explain a little bit about how the Russian ground-based air defenses work. Russia is widely considered to be the country that has the very best ground-based air defenses of any country, and there is a good historical reason for that. During the Cold War, you would typically see the best aircraft belong to the United States. All new developments in aircraft technology would usually first emerge in the United States, and the USSR would counter this by developing their own ground-based air defenses. The USSR and then Russia has been evolving its ground-based air defenses for many, many decades since the 1950s, and they have had to resort to some crazy measures in order to be able to withstand a NATO air force. There are a few ways to destroy any air defense network. The first way is to simply saturate air defenses with lots of small, cheap rockets or loitering munitions, and long-range air defenses are especially vulnerable to this. Let's see what the Russians have developed in order to protect their ground-based air defenses. This is the Pantsir S1. There is also a Pantsir S2. There are also a few other systems that the Russians use, but I really want to place emphasis on the Pantsir for now. The Pantsir is a small vehicle-mounted air defense battery. It has 12 short-range missiles. It also has a heavy machine gun, which can destroy things like drones, loitering munitions, cruise missiles, rockets, etc. These vehicles are almost always used to protect long-range air defenses like the S-300, S-400, etc. You also see many other platforms, such as the Tor, which is actually capable of shooting targets as it is moving, so it's capable of both moving and shooting down cruise missiles or aircraft at the same time. You also have a lot of other equipment that is used in general. Russia really relies on this concept of overlapping ranges. So you have your very long range air defense system, such as the S-300, S-400. Then you have slightly shorter ranged air defenses, such as the S-350. Then you have medium ranged air defenses, such as the Buk M2, Buk M3. Then you have your short ranged air defenses, such as the Tor. And then you have the very short-ranged air defenses, such as the Pantsir S1 and S2, and also some older Tunguskas. All of this equipment is especially used to protect the large, heavy radars that long-ranged air defense batteries need in order to hit their targets. In order to see anything, an air defense platform needs to be guided by a radar. However, turning on a radar is like turning on a very bright flashlight in the middle of the night. Everybody is going to shoot that flashlight. This is why it is so critical to protect these radars using all of that equipment. Radars are not very mobile, especially large radars. Once you set them up, it takes something like half an hour or even a full hour in order to make that radar mobile again. This is where I would again like to remind everyone that radar would be within range of the PLA's artillery. It would be destroyed. This brings me to another point that I would like to make about Russia. Russia is a huge country. In terms of area, Russia is the biggest country in the world. Russia's air defense doctrine, in fact, any country's air defense doctrine, would need to rely on massive massive swaths of land, which can hide all sorts of air defense platforms, which can also be used to temporarily retreat, and most importantly, for all of the critical equipment to be kept well outside the range of enemy missiles, especially enemy artillery, such as rocket artillery. Another good way to defeat ground-based air defenses is to fly very low and close to the ground. This was first used en masse during the Vietnam War, where North Vietnam had lots of what were at the time very capable air defense batteries supplied to them by the Soviet Union. In order to overcome them, the United States Air Force developed many new tactics and many new strategies, one of which was to fly their aircraft very close to the ground to ensure that enemy radar cannot pick up that aircraft. The reason flying close to the ground works is because you have this concept of a radar horizon, where if the aircraft is flying very, very high, then it will be detected from hundreds of kilometers. But if the aircraft is flying very low, then it cannot be detected by a radar, no matter how powerful it is, because the ground is going to block the radar waves. In order to overcome the problem of cruise missiles, which all fly very low to the ground, the Russian military has done a few things. First of all, they've actually developed over-the-horizon radars. They have developed radars which can be reflected from the water, which can be reflected from the upper atmosphere. Thereby, they can be used to actually look at targets that are over the horizon. Now, such radars are very, very large. They have to operate at a specific low frequency, which does not allow these radars to view these objects in anything like a high resolution. It can only really be used to detect things like warships. Maybe it can be used to detect clusters of cruise missiles or many aircraft flying in formation. There are rumors that it has been used to detect even single aircraft, but that is not known for certain. Another thing that the Russians have developed are these massive, massive radar masts. They have these masts that can be put up within 30 minutes that can be retracted. And when they are placed, they allow a radar to stay something like 30 meters above the ground, where the radar horizon is 2.5-3 times farther away. That gives the air defenses much more time to react to any low-flying targets. Yet another thing that the Russians have, which Taiwan doesn't, is a large air force. Russia has about 800 modern tactical aircraft. These tactical aircraft are created to operate in tandem with the ground-based air defenses. In the Soviet era, you would actually see the Soviet Union have two separate air forces, one of which was the regular air force, another one of which was the air defense air force. The Soviet Union actually had thousands and thousands of aircraft in its air defense forces. Now it's all operated within one branch, but the main idea is the same. These tactical aircraft are meant to chase down and shoot down any enemy aircraft that would try to employ hit and run attacks. You also have things like these massive, massive AWACS. The idea behind these AWACS is that they can illuminate a whole battlefield. They can show you where all of the enemy's air assets are within hundreds and hundreds of kilometers. And they are not limited by the radar horizon because they're already mounted on top of an aircraft. They can already fly many kilometers above the ground, thereby illuminating targets hundreds of kilometers away. Taiwan has an air force that is very weak. It is not going to have that air force after the initial rocket bombardment of all of their military airfields. Another way to defeat ground-based air defenses is to use stealthy aircraft. Stealthy aircraft are much more difficult to see with many radars. Using regular radars, the range at which you can expect to pick up a stealthy aircraft is somewhere between 5 and 10 times lower than for a non-stealthy aircraft. To overcome this problem, Russia has developed tons of different anti-stealth radars. These radars operate on lower frequencies in wavelengths where stealthy aircraft are not nearly as stealthy. They are also very powerful. Taiwan does not have anything remotely resembling this. Taiwan only has your regular X-band radars, radars that are around the X-band. It doesn't have VHF, UHF radars, and even if it did, those would be very quickly destroyed. So in terms of anti-stealth, Taiwan is likewise completely outmatched. Here is the real kicker, however. Despite all of these measures for air defense, the Russians do not expect that their air defenses are going to be some sort of invincible bubble against the NATO air force. The Russian air defense doctrine does not state that there needs to be, or even can be, some sort of invincible bubble. The Russians assume that sooner or later, their air defenses will be taken down. They will slowly be whittled away until there is nothing left. The idea behind these air defenses is to give the regular Russian ground troops enough time to conduct whatever military missions they have to be able to destroy the enemy's airfields, prevent the enemy aircraft from taking off before these air defenses can be destroyed. Also, these air defenses are mainly there to prevent NATO from hitting much more important Russian targets on the ground or some important strategic targets. All of this is to say that ground-based air defenses do not create some sort of kill circle where anything that ventures within range of the air defense is going to be immediately shot down. That's not how air defenses work. Ground-based air defenses in a vacuum are actually always going to be outmatched by an advanced enemy air force. No matter how developed those air defenses are, sooner or later, they will be destroyed. But let's talk a little bit about how advanced the Taiwanese ground-based air defenses are. The Antelope air defense system is a rough equivalent to the Russian Pantsir S1 and Pantsir S2. It is mounted on a truck. It has a fairly powerful phased array radar. It can only carry 4 missiles. It does not have a machine gun that can shoot down missiles. So in terms of surviving a saturation strike, it really is not going to fare very well. As far as long-ranged air defenses are concerned, the Taiwanese have a few different platforms. They have a number of very old MIM-23 Hawks that they brought from the United States. These missiles are from the 1960s. You cannot expect them to have any good performance against modern aircraft. They are not very mobile at all. They are not going to have lots of range. They don't have powerful radars. Their radars are mostly analog radars. They can easily be jammed. You cannot expect these missiles, these air defense batteries, to have any notable effect. Then you have some Patriot PAC-3s that the Taiwanese have again brought from the Americans. The Patriot missile battery is far from the best missile battery in the world. The United States does not have great ground-based air defense vehicles. The United States always assumes that it is going to have air superiority, even air supremacy, anywhere that it operates. Therefore, the United States has never bothered to create very good air defense platforms like the S-400, or even like what China has. Finally, you have the Taiwanese domestic rough equivalent of the Patriot, which is called the Tiangong 3. There is also an older Tiangong 2. These are fairly capable missile batteries. Their problem is that they use the same radars as the Patriots. They do not have very advanced radars. The radars that the Patriot missiles use have a fairly limited range. They have a range of around 150 kilometers, but they will be going up against stealthy aircraft, so you can imagine that number being cut down to something like 20 kilometers. And then you also have to introduce electronic jamming into the equation. These batteries will not survive very long. None of these radars are actually going to survive very long. That's another issue. The radars themselves are very, very vulnerable. They're within artillery range of the Chinese mainland, and they do not have very capable platforms defending these missile batteries. Taiwan knows all of this. A few years ago, the Taiwanese president has actually expressed the desire to make more of these air defense batteries, to make more standoff weapons, to deter a potential Chinese assault. I do not think that these platforms would make any difference, no matter how many of them there are. And this, again, is not just my opinion. This is also the conclusion of a detailed study, which ultimately said that even if you take stealthy aircraft out of the equation, the study itself was conducted before the PLA had these stealthy aircraft, that even the oldest fighters, even F-5 fighters that are straight from the Cold War, are going to make a bigger difference than these air defense platforms. All of this is to say that the war over the air will be a very, very one-sided war, and it will be over very quickly, decisively, in the PRC's favor. Many military analysts assume that after the air war, mainland China is just going to gather all of its forces. It's going to use its amphibious assault fleet to conduct an amphibious landing operation 1944 Normandy style. I do not think that that is going to be the case. I think that upon achieving total air supremacy, mainland China is going to use that total air supremacy. It's going to carry out a very extensive bombing campaign, destroying all Taiwanese military formations on Taiwan. You would likely have at least one carrier group somewhere near Taiwan, possibly on the other side, while another carrier group is going to be somewhere in the Pacific, keeping a watch on the Americans, preventing them from interfering in this conflict. China would also probably deploy a few of its helicopter carriers. It really only has one, which is soon due to enter service. But much more important than all of this are Chinese drones. Once China establishes total air dominance, there will be nothing that can shoot down even a small drone that the Chinese will deploy. China has some of the best drone warfare capabilities on the planet. It has drones that are capable of maintaining surveillance over an area the size of Egypt. These drones, such as the CH-5, have endurances of several days. They are able to maintain flight for several days on end. A lot of people assume that Taiwan is going to be able to pull off a Yugoslavia here. During the 1998 and 1999 NATO bombing of Yugoslavia, the Serbian army was actually able to deceive NATO air forces on many occasions. They would do things like use old microwaves, turn on these microwaves, point them at the sky, and the NATO aircraft would pick up the radiation coming from them and assume that it was a radar. And then it would waste an expensive bomb to destroy an old microwave. So the Serbians did a lot of things like that. However, technology has gone a very long way since 1998. Modern sensors are much more advanced and much more sensitive. Plus, you have neural nets. I think that a neural net would have absolutely no issues distinguishing between a decoy and an actual target, even if that decoy was visually made to resemble the actual target. We are living in the age of AI right now. The drones that China is going to be using here are probably not even going to be controlled by operators on the ground. At least some of them, I would imagine, would be controlled by artificial intelligence. The AI would conduct surveillance on everything on its own. It would report any important information back to headquarters. And then in the headquarters, the operator's job would probably only be to give the green light to the AI to bomb some target. Such an extensive drone campaign is going to absolutely decimate the Taiwanese military. In fact, I don't think that there would be anything left of the Taiwanese military by this point. You also have to consider that all of this would come with a blockade. While the war is happening, there would be a blockade. And because of that blockade, Taiwan is not going to be able to rely on its fishing industry. The Taiwanese fishing industry comprises more than 20% of the entire agriculture industry. The agriculture on land would also be disrupted because there is a war happening. A lot of infrastructure would be temporarily disabled. And Taiwan, on top of all of that, is not going to be able to import anything. Taiwan is going to need a lot of food for war. First of all, it's going to have to feed its own civilian population. Second of all, it's going to have to feed its military, especially if it chooses to mobilize its reservists. Soldiers in war need something like double the food that a civilian might need, or a soldier that is not undertaking combat missions would need. So a lot of food needs to be delivered. Plus, that food needs to be delivered without being destroyed by these drones and by these aircraft. A drone campaign can whittle down the Taiwanese military to basically nothing. A lot of people say that Taiwan has lots of anti-ship missiles. Taiwan bought something like 400 or 500 Harpoon anti-ship missiles, to which Taiwan's president Tsai Ing-wen once said that it is enough to sink more than half of the PLA amphibious assault fleet. Those Harpoon missiles are not going to exist. Mainland China is going to be absolutely certain to destroy all possible threats before it chooses to land its forces on Taiwan. Now we're going to talk a little bit about the actual landing force. After the Air Force has been reduced to nothing, after the Taiwanese ground army has been reduced to almost nothing, it is going to be time for the PLA to conduct an amphibious landing operation on Taiwan. Make no mistake, China's amphibious transport fleet is massive. The Type 071, which China has 8 of, are each the size of a World War II aircraft carrier or a World War II battleship. These are massive ships, each of which can transport a full battalion of soldiers and lots of equipment, lots of tanks to go along with that. Helicopters can take off from mainland China and support troops on Taiwan. You also have a helicopter carrier that is very soon due to enter service. Plus, on top of this, China has dozens and dozens of smaller ships the size of frigates. There is also the Chinese Maritime Militia, which is a paramilitary force, but it has hundreds of ships, which will be used for logistical support. China can transport probably on the order of 10 to 20,000 troops per day onto the beaches of Taiwan. A lot of people make the assertion that this landing operation can only take place in April or October because that is when the weather is calm enough. But that is also untrue. That assumes that there will be a large Taiwanese army ready to meet any amphibious assault. There will be no army because, again, drones are going to completely destroy any army that is out in the open. You also have to keep in mind that China has lots of strategic transport aircraft. These transport aircraft can carry supplies, they can carry paratroopers, they can even paradrop equipment. China has vehicles that it built specifically for this purpose. A lot of analysts assume that China's Type 15 light tank is specifically built to be paradropped onto Taiwan. This is a light tank. It weighs something like 33 tons. It is armed with a 105mm rifled main gun. It has some fairly advanced electronics, a very powerful engine. You know what the funny thing is? Despite this being a light tank, it is actually better armed, has more advanced sensors, and probably even has better armor than Taiwanese main battle tanks. Taiwan uses the M48 and M60 main battle tanks, which are straight from the 1950s, 1960s, and 1970s. Again, this is old Cold War era American technology that the Taiwanese have purchased from the Americans. Even if some of these tanks are not going to be destroyed by drones, I think that the Type 15 is going to be able to defeat any such tanks in tank versus tank combat. Despite the fact that this tank was not built for tank versus tank combat, it was built for operations in mountainous landscapes, in difficult terrain such as dense forests, where heavier main battle tanks can experience lots of issues. The Taiwanese army consists of something like 160,000 men, many of which are conscripts. Given any real combat, I highly doubt that all of them are going to be ready and willing to fight, not only because of the aforementioned pro-CCP and pro-mainland sentiment in Taiwan, but also because these are conscripts that would not want to commit suicide by PLA. The only area in which I see the PLA having some troubles is urban warfare. Despite all advancements in technology that happened over the last 50, 60 years, urban warfare is still as messy as it ever was, probably even more so. When it comes to urban warfare, the PLA can still enjoy its total supremacy over the skies, even if it is mainly going to be used for surveillance. But the PLA also has a lot better equipment. It has a lot more soldiers, on the order of 2 million. It also has much better trained soldiers. The PLA does not use conscription. All of the soldiers in the PLA are volunteers. They are well-trained volunteers. They are going to be very well-equipped. Given all of this, I think that even in city warfare, the PLA is not going to suffer many, many casualties. If we still assume that the Taiwanese defenders are going to fight almost to the death, then I think the PLA would see something on the order of 5,000 casualties. This is admittedly a wild guess on my part. I'm going to say 5,000 deaths, so casualties. That's not including non-fatal injuries. However, in any practical scenario, I do not see the Taiwanese military having anywhere near the fanatic morale that would be required to fight in this scenario. I think that the Taiwanese military is going to surrender once they see that they are hopelessly outmatched and that they would not want to die fighting their Chinese compatriots. This is how badly Taiwan is outmatched militarily. Taiwan has no chance in a shooting war against mainland China. This is something that I really want to emphasize. It is dangerous to think that Taiwan can somehow militarily defeat or even deter mainland China. Taiwan is utterly outmatched militarily. So let me know if you agree with this analysis. Let me also know if I got anything wrong. Let me know if you think that Taiwan has some other ways in which it can deter mainland China militarily or otherwise.